Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Killer Blonde by Laura Levine, narrated by Brittany Pressley.
Prologue. My name is Jaine, and I'm a bathaholic. Yes, it's true. I like nothing better than to tear off my clothes in the middle of the afternoon and leap into a hot bubble bath. So it's lucky I'm a freelance writer. While other working stiffs are trapped in offices, chained to their computers, I can hop into the tub anytime I please. Which is what I was doing the day SueEllen Kingsley first called me. I'd just finished writing a slogan for a new client, Tip Top Dry Cleaners. We'll clean for you, we'll press for you, we'll even die for you. And I was relaxing in a marvelous haze of strawberry-scented bubbles. The mirrors were fogged over. The radio, if I remember correctly, was playing a soulful Diana Krall love song, and my cat Prozac was perched on top of the toilet tank, licking her privates, visions of fish guts dancing in her head. It was one of those blissful moments I often experience after I finished a writing assignment, basking in the glow of a job well done, or done, anyway, until it dawns on me that now that the assignment is over, I'm out of work again. I was still in the bask in the glow stage when the phone rang. I let the machine get it. Ms. Austen? A syrupy, southern-accented voice drifted out from the machine. SueEllen Kingsley here. I saw your ad in the Yellow Pages. Yippee, a prospective client. And I'm calling because I need a ghostwriter to help me write a book. At the sound of the word ghostwriter, my enthusiasm came to a screeching halt. In my experience, people who are looking for ghostwriters often fall into the mentally unstable category. These are people who want to tell the world about how they were abducted to the planet Clorox and forced to have sex with spatulas, or people who believe that they're the love child of Wayne Newton and Golda Meir. SueEllen Kingsley left her number on my machine. For a minute, I considered not returning the call, but then I remembered a few pesky facts of life, like my rent and my visa bill and my impossible-to-kick Ben and Jerry's chunky monkey habit. Reluctantly, I hauled myself out of the tub and into a worn chenille bathrobe. Then I shuffled over to the phone and dialed. If I'd known what I was getting into, I would have stayed up to my eyeballs in soap suds. Chapter 1. SueEllen Kingsley answered the phone, her voice as gooey as melted Velveeta. Ms. Austen, she oozed, can you hustle your fanny over to my house in an hour? I assured her I was an expert at fanny hustling, and she gave me the directions to her house, which turned out to be more like a castle. A vintage Spanish estate nestled in one of Beverly's niftiest hills. The house was a showstopper. Its arches and balustrades and red tile roof glistened in the mid-afternoon sun. The whole thing was so Spanish mannerish, I almost expected to see Zorro leap onto one of the many balconies with a rose in his teeth. But there was no sign of Zorro. The only Hispanic in sight was a gardener pruning the bougainvillea. I drove up a circular driveway and parked my humble Corolla next to a gleaming Bentley. Then I checked my teeth in my rearview mirror for any stray pieces of lettuce left over from the jumbo jack I'd picked up on my way over. Satisfied that all was clear on the dental front, I gave myself a quick blast of Bananca and tugged a few unruly curls back into my ponytail. Finally, plucking a stray French fry from my lap, I got out of the Corolla and looked around. What a palace. The kind of place God would build if he had money. I was beginning to regret my decision to wear my usual work outfit of jeans and a blazer. A place like this called for something a lot fancier, like the British crown jewels and a blazer. Why the heck was a woman with SueEllen's money calling a writer from the Yellow Pages? I'd checked her out on Google before I left my apartment, and found her name scattered on the society pages of the Los Angeles Times. SueEllen was apparently a party giver and fundraiser par excellence. Surely she had access to scads of well-known writers. So why, I asked myself again, had she called anonymous old me? Oh well. Who cared why she called? Just as long as her check didn't bounce. And from the looks of the place, I was sure it wouldn't. I headed up the front path and rang the bell. Now, I don't know if they have a doorbell at Versailles, but if they do, I'll bet it sounds just like the Kingsleys. A series of mellifluous bongs resonated from inside the house. Seconds later, the door was opened by a timid Hispanic maid holding a bottle of Windex. Hi, I smiled. I'm Jaine Austen. I have an appointment with Mrs. Kingsley. Si, she said, eyes lowered, clutching her Windex to her chest. She spoke softly in a heavily accented voice.
Mrs. Kingsley having her massage. She wants you to wait in the living room.
I followed her as we hiked across the foyer. A wide, curving staircase with gleaming mahogany banisters ascended to the floor above. I almost expected to see Scarlett O'Hara come skipping down the steps, twirling her parasol. The living room was huge, with hardwood floors, an exposed wood-beam ceiling, and a fireplace as big as my kitchen. I took a seat in one of the many overstuffed armchairs dotted throughout the room. The maid asked me if I wanted anything to drink and seemed relieved when I said no. As she skittered away, presumably to do battle with dirty windows, I glanced down and saw a grease stain on my blouse, probably from the French fry that dropped in my lap. Oh, great. Now I'd have to spend the entire interview with my blazer buttoned, which wasn't going to be easy since I'd bought the blazer two sizes too small. It was on sale at Ann Taylor, the only one they had left, reduced 70%. I went ahead and bought it, figuring I'd never have to button the damn thing. Now I sucked in my gut and was struggling with the buttons when I heard,
"You'll never last a week."
I looked across the room and for the first time, I noticed a young girl nestled in an armchair underneath a huge bay window. She was a chubby kid, about 15, with soft brown eyes and an old-fashioned Dutch boy haircut. Something about her looked vaguely familiar, and then I realized, good heavens, she was me at 15. Not that I have brown eyes, mine are green, and when I was 15, I wasn't quite as chunky as this girl. But there was something about her that reminded me of the young Jaine Austen. Maybe it was the book she was reading, Stiff Upper Lip, by the British humorist P.G. Wodehouse. When I was a teenager, I was crazy about his books. In fact, I still am. But it's not every day you see a teenager reading Wodehouse.
"Nobody ever lasts a week," she said, looking up at me from under her thick bangs. "Sooner or later, they all quit."
So that's why SueEllen was willing to hire a writer from the Yellow Pages. No reputable writer would work for her.
"She's nice at first, but then she turns mean. You'll see."
"So your mom's tough to work for, huh?" The kid looked at me as if I'd just offered her a worm for lunch.
"SueEllen isn't my mother," she said, with all the warmth of Christina Crawford talking about Joan. "She's my stepmother. My real mother's dead."
"I'm sorry."
"Yeah," she said. "Me too."
And with that, she picked up her book and began reading. Conversation terminated.
"Miss Austen?"
The Hispanic maid was at the door, still clutching her Windex. I only wished she had some stain remover for the grease spot on my blouse.
"Mrs. Kingsley will see you now," she said.
I got up to go. I tried to button my blazer, but it was no use. SueEllen Kingsley would have to accept me as I was, grease stain and all. "Nice meeting you," I said to the kid in the chair.
"Whatever,"
was her jolly reply. I followed the maid up a flight of stairs and down what seemed like an endless hallway. If I'd known how big this place was, I would have worn hiking shoes. Halfway down the corridor,
We ran into a bubbly blonde carrying a portable massage table. She weighed about as much as my right leg.
Hi, Conchi,
she said to the maid. Then she turned to me, beaming me an impossibly white smile.
I'm Larkspur O'Leary, SueEllen's masseuse.
Larkspur O'Leary? And I thought my mom was bad naming me Jaine Austen.
You must be the new writer, she said.
No, not exactly. I'm just here for an interview. I haven't got the job yet.
Oh, you will. You look very capable. And besides, SueEllen's desperate.
She beamed me another smile, almost blinding me in the process.
Here's my card.
She handed me a pastel pink business card with her name printed in a flowery script.
I use a special method of massage that breaks down the fat cells and gets rid of cellulite.
She let her glance linger on my thighs, which, I have to admit, are home to a happy colony of fat cells. Thanks, I'll keep that in mind.
We'll see ya,
she said. Then she started down the hallway, swinging her massage table as if it were a bag of Fritos. For a tiny thing, she was awfully strong.
Oh, and good luck, she called back, and then she added with a wink, you're going to need it.
I smiled weakly and followed Conchi down the endless hallway. At last, we reached our destination. Conchi opened the door to a bathroom straight out of Architectural Digest, gleaming with marble, gold fixtures, and light streaming in from overhead skylights. At first, I thought she'd taken leave of her senses. Why on earth would she be bringing me to the bathroom? Clearly the woman had been sniffing too many Windex fumes.
Miss Austen, I presume?
I looked over and saw my prospective employer, SueEllen Kingsley, stretched out in a tub so big it could hold the entire cast of Friends and still have room left over for Drew Carey. The first thing I noticed about SueEllen were her boobs. Two perfect pink globes bobbing in the water like cantaloupes. Later, I would notice her tawny hair, her tiny waist, and her fine-boned face, with an unlikely smattering of freckles on her nose. But not at first. No, all I saw at first were those incredible boobs.
Like 'em?
SueEllen asked, following my gaze.
Their birthday gift for my husband.
Talk about a gift for the gal who has everything.
Hal's a plastic surgeon. All the stars go to him. He gives great liposuction,
she added, taking a none too discreet glance at my thighs. I was getting a bit miffed at the way everybody seemed to be taking pot shots at my thighs. Okay, so I'm no supermodel, but that doesn't mean I don't have feelings.
That'll be all, Conchi, SueEllen said, waving the maid away with her loofah sponge.
Conchi scurried out of the room, like an infantryman trying to stay out of the line of fire.
Have a seat,
SueEllen said, gesturing to the toilet bowl. I sat down on the toilet lid, crossing my arms over my chest to hide the grease spot on my blouse and trying not to look as uncomfortable as I felt.
I hope you don't mind my interviewing you in the bathroom, SueEllen said.
Not at all, I lied.
But this is where I work, she said, washing between her toes. I get my best ideas in the bathtub.
Me too, actually. It's where I thought up the slogan for one of my biggest clients, Toilet Masters Plumbers. Okay, so Toilet Masters wasn't exactly a Fortune 500 company, but at the moment it was the shining star on my resume.
In a rush to flush, call Toilet Masters? You thought of that?
I nodded modestly. The woman was actually impressed.
That's wonderful, honey. I can see you're just oozing with talent. Have you ever ghostwritten a book?
Yes, I said. Once.
What was it about?
It was sort of a memoir. Please don't let her ask me what it was called.
What was it called?
I took a deep breath and spat it out. Sensitive readers may want to skip the following sentence. I was Henry Kissinger's sex slave? Really? SueEllen said.
So was I.
What?
Only kidding,
she said, laughing at her own gag.
her incredible breasts bouncing like buoys in the ocean. "Ha ha," I managed weakly. "I suppose you want to know what my book is about. Of course, it's about entertaining." I smiled a genuine smile of relief, grateful that there were no space aliens involved. "Sounds great." "Oh, it will be," she said, sudsing a long, lean, cellulite-free thigh. "I don't know if you've ever seen my name in the papers, but I'm just about the most popular hostess on the Beverly Hills party circuit. People kill for invitations to my parties. So, now I'm going to share my entertaining secrets with the public. I'll give recipes and talk about how to hire a caterer and tell all sorts of marvelous anecdotes from my past. I've led a very colorful life, you know." I didn't doubt that for a minute. "So how about it?" she said. "You interested?" "What exactly did you have in mind as a salary?"
$3,000.
"I don't know," I said. $3,000 isn't much. After all, the book will take months to write."
"Not $3,000 for the whole book, silly. $3,000 a week."
Suddenly, the toilet didn't seem so uncomfortable after all. Chapter 2.
$3,000 a week?
My best friend, Candy Tobolowski, sat across from me at our favorite Mexican restaurant, Paco's Tacos, where everything is defiantly fried in lard and the combination plates have been known to send healthy men hurtling into cardiac arrest. Candy and I have been best friends ever since we met at a UCLA screenwriting course. We hit it off right away, in spite of the fact that she's reed thin and has fabulous chestnut hair that never frizzes in the rain. I told her all about my new job with SueEllen Kingsley, and now we were celebrating.
$3,000 a week? She said. That's fantastic.
I know, I said, flagging down a passing waiter. Garçon, I called out, give me a bottle of your very best champagne. The guy looked at me like I was nuts.
We don't have champagne, señorita.
Then bring us a pitcher of your very best margaritas. He nodded and headed off to the bar.
Can you believe it?
I said, scooping a wad of guacamole onto a chip. All I have to do is write down a couple of recipes, throw in a few anecdotes, and I bring home $3,000 a week.
That's great news, sweetie, Candy said. But I've got even better news for you.
What could be better than $3,000 a week?
Tommy the Termite wants to go out with you.
Tommy the Termite? Who on earth is that? Sounds like a mafia hitman.
No, silly, he's an actor from my show.
Candy is a writer for the animated cartoon series, Beanie and the Cockroach. For those of you lucky enough to have never seen it, it's a stirring saga about a chef named Beanie and his pet cockroach, Fred.
His name is Ted Lawson. He's very cute, and apparently he's just broken up with his girlfriend.
Sorry, Candy, I said, but I'm not dating an actor slash insect. I scooped up another glob of guacamole while Candy took a tiny bite off the corner of a chip, which is why Candy wears a size 6 and I wear a size... Well, never mind what size I wear. Let's just say it's somewhere in the double digits.
What am I going to do with you, Jaine? You sit alone in your apartment night after night, and when opportunity comes knocking, you hide under the sofa cushions. Do you want to wind up a crazy old lady who gives birthday parties for her cats?
What, may I ask, is wrong with giving a birthday party for one's cat? Candy's eyes widened.
Don't tell me you give Prozac birthday parties.
Yes, in fact, I do. And for your information, she really enjoys them. I put a birthday candle in her can of fancy mackerel guts, and afterwards we eat cake and ice cream. Okay, so I eat the cake and ice cream, but Prozac licks the lid. Candy shook her head.
I can't believe you're passing up a chance to go out with a wonderful guy to stay home and work on your relationship with your cat.
Sorry, but you're going to have to tell this termite guy I'm not interested.
No, Candy said. You're going to have to tell him. I already gave him your number.
Candy, how could you?
What's the big deal? When he calls, just say no. You've had plenty of practice.
I will, don't worry. And besides, if he's so great, why don't you go out with him?
I can't.
Candy's eyes lit up with excitement.
I'm dating someone.
Really? Who?
A martial arts instructor.
How on earth did you meet a martial arts instructor?
He's teaching a self-defense course at the studio. One of the producers on the lot got assaulted on the way to our car by an angry rider, so now they're making us study self-defense. Oh, Jaine, he is such a doll. So manly and sure of himself, unlike the cerebral wimps I usually waste my time on.
Does Mr. Manly have a name?
Matt Malone. Isn't that a great name? It's so no frills.
How long have you been seeing him?
Well, he hasn't exactly asked me out yet, but I know he will.
That's Candy for you. Ever the optimist.
It's obvious he likes me. He keeps calling me up to the front of the class for demonstrations. Last night, I kicked him in the groin. Not really, but he showed me where to aim. God, it was sexy. I'm telling you, Jaine, she said, dabbing at the guacamole with the tines of her fork. This time I've met Mr. Wright.
I smiled weakly. Candy meets an average of 2.38 Mr. Wrights per month, and 2.37 of them turn out to be duds. The amazing thing, though, is that she never gives up. She sails from one guy to the next, never bloodied, never bowed. Unlike yours truly, who threw in the towel after one measly marriage. True, it was the marriage from hell, but lots of other women recover from bad marriages. Why didn't I? I'll tell you why. Because those other women weren't married to the blob. That's what I call my ex-husband. I didn't always call him the blob. Back when we were still married, I called him my first husband. I should have known I was in trouble when he wore flip-flops to our wedding. I'll spare you the painful details of the rest of our 4 years together. Let's just say that by the time the divorce was final, I was ready to check into a convent and throw away the key.
Here you go, señoritas.
The waiter was at our table with a pitcher of margaritas. He poured us each a frosty glass.
Here's to your new job, Candy said, and my new relationship.
As fate would have it, neither lasted 2 weeks. Mommy's home, I called out as I let myself into my apartment, which, for all you architecture fans out there, is a 1940s duplex in the low-rent area of Beverly Hills. Not that the rent is actually low, but it seems that way compared to the Casa Kingsleys of the world. Prozac raised her head from where she was napping on my best cashmere sweater and looked at me through slitted eyes. When will you get over the ridiculous notion that you're my mother? She seemed to be saying. In case you've forgotten, one of us is a cat and the other a mere mortal. I know she doesn't like it when I call myself Mommy, but I'm the one footing the cat food bills, so Mommy it is. Mommy's got a new job, I said, scratching her belly. And guess how much I'm getting paid, schnookums? $3,000 lovely dollars a week. That's enough to keep you in albacore tuna morning, noon, and night. Her eyes shot open wide. Just the mention of food can do that to her. We're a lot alike, my Prozac and I. The phone rang and I got it.
$3,000 a week, congratulations.
It was Lance Venable, my next-door neighbor. I couldn't help overhearing, he said. And it's true, the man has X-ray hearing. Really, Lance hears toilets flushing in West Covina, which was pretty disconcerting when I first moved into my apartment, but I've gotten used to it now.
So, tell me all about your new job.
And I did. Wow, he said when I was through. SueEllen Kingsley, I see your picture in the society pages all the time. What amazing tits. You really saw them naked? Yep, they float. How come nothing fun like that ever happens at my job? He pouted. All I get to see are bunions. Lance is a shoe salesman at Neiman Marcus. Tall and thin with a head full of silky blonde curls, Lance has been working at Neiman's ever since I've known him. Unlike the other shoe salesmen at Neiman's,
Lance is not an aspiring actor slash director. He knows he doesn't want to spend the rest of his life selling shoes, but so far, he hasn't figured out what he does want to do. So he spends his days fondling insteps and is kind enough to let me use his employee discount. Which means that instead of paying $500 for a pair of outrageously overpriced shoes, all I have to pay is $400. Not that I'd ever dream of paying $400 for a pair of shoes, but I could if I wanted to, thanks to Lance. And who knows, now that I was making 3,000 smackers a week, I just might. We gabbed some more, mainly about Lance's new boyfriend, a Brentwood real estate broker. "Jim's so great," he gushed. "I only wish you'd meet a guy too. Straight, of course." He babbled on about how kind, caring, handsome, loving, sexy, talented Jim was. I'd been down this road with him before, just like I'd been with Candy, and I knew that as sure as Prozac would wolf down her next meal, there'd be heartbreak ahead. When it comes to picking boyfriends, apparently men are just as clueless as women, which is why I, for one, am perfectly happy with a cat as my significant other. Finally, Lance wound down about the joys of Jim, and we hung up. I headed to the kitchen to get some kitty treats for Prozac and some Ben and Jerry's for me. Then I checked my email. Nothing except an offer to have hot cyber sex with a woman named Brandy. And some letters from my parents. I decided to read my parents' letters in the morning. I didn't want anything to bring me down off my $3,000 a week high. Don't get me wrong. I love my mom and dad. But frankly, they're... How can I put this gently? They're stark raving bonkers? To look at them, you'd think they're just an average 60-something couple living in a retirement community in Tampa, Florida. But the truth is, their lives are straight out of a soap opera. Somehow, they always seem to be in the middle of a crisis. A crisis they expect me to solve. I've read about people like my parents. People who don't feel alive unless they're swirling in a maelstrom of drama. Daddy is the main culprit. This is a guy who can take a perfectly ordinary day and turn it into an episode of Survivor. As my mom often says, Daddy doesn't have ulcers, he's just a carrier. Mom's only major lapse into nuttyhood, aside from marrying Daddy, is her fanatic devotion to the home shopping club. The woman has enough cubic zirconia to light up Times Square. But enough about my parents. I'm sure you've got parents of your own to worry about. The point is, I'd had a good day and I wanted to keep it that way. I wasn't in the mood for a domestic crisis or one of Daddy's bad email jokes. I'd definitely save their letters for tomorrow. Instead, I settled into bed with Ben, Jerry, and Prozac. The four of us happily watched an old Doris Day movie. At the beginning of the movie, Doris is a sensible woman, happy to be alone and independent, not moping around dreaming of having a man in her life. Why couldn't Candy and Lance be more like me and Doris? But then, of course, Doris falls head over heels in love with Rock Hudson and defects to the Lance-Candy camp. I thought about Lance and Candy and their quest for Mr. Wright. What do you think? I said, scooping Prozac up into my arms. Are they the smart ones for trying? Am I a fool for holing myself up in the apartment with you? Should I give it one more chance and go out with that guy from Candy's show? Prozac purred in my arms, doing her best to look adorable. Of course you're better off holed up here with me. Who wouldn't be? The phone rang. It was Lance. What guy from Candy's show? I told him what little I knew about Tommy the termite. Promise me you'll go out with him, he said. I won't hang up till you promise. So I promised and we hung up. I turned out the light, Doris and Rock still flickering in the background. Maybe I would go out with Mr. Termite. And maybe one of these days, when I talked to a man in bed, there wouldn't be a wall between us. You've got mail. To Jostin, from Shop Till You Drop. Subject, you'll never guess what your father's done now.
Well, honey, I hope things are fine in Los Angeles, because they sure aren't fine here in Florida. You'll never guess what your father's done now. He's gone and bought a toupee. It wouldn't be so bad if he'd bought a regular toupee or joined the hair club for men like a normal human being. But no, your father bought the darn thing at a thrift shop. That's right, he bought a used toupee. We were at the thrift shop, donating some clothing, when suddenly I looked up and saw Daddy with this ratty brown monstrosity on his head. I swear, Jaine, it looks just like squirrel fur. I begged him not to buy it, but you know how stubborn your father can be once he makes up his mind.
Where am I going to find another toupee like this? He asked.
Try the city dump, I said. But he ignored me and bought it anyway. He insisted on wearing it out of the store. I was so darn angry I didn't even tell him that the price tag was dangling down his neck. And now he's strutting around like he's God's gift to women. He thinks people are staring at him because he looks dashing, when the truth is, they're staring because he looks like a recent escapee from a lunatic asylum. Today, at the Tampa Vistas clubhouse, old Mrs. Faraday took one look at the toupee and said, "What a cute hat, just like the one Omar Sharif wore in Dr. Zhivago." You'd think your father would be embarrassed, but no. He says Mrs. Faraday is senile and wouldn't know a quality toupee if it sat in her lap. Even worse, now he thinks he looks like Omar Sharif. Honestly, Jaine, with that toupee on, your father is a totally different person. It's like living with a stranger with a dead squirrel on his head. I told him I absolutely refused to have Dipsy Doodle with him if he wore that damn thing to bed. And so, for the time being at least, he's taking it off at night. Love from Mom. To Shop Till You Drop, from Jostin. Subject, try not to worry. Please, Mom, the less I know about you and Daddy dipsy-doodling, the better. Try not to worry. Daddy's always trying new things. Sooner or later, he gets tired of them. Remember the time he bought that case of Factory Seconds self-tanning lotion, and he was convinced he looked like George Hamilton until his skin turned orange? To Jostin, from Shop Till You Drop. Yes, I remember. We're still paying the dermatologist's bills. To Jostin, from Daddy-O. Subject, good news. Hi, Cookie. Did Mom tell you the good news? I bought a toupee, a top-quality hairpiece, and what a difference it makes. I look years younger, and not only that, keeps my head warm, too. Especially in air-conditioned restaurants. I'll bet I won't catch half as many colds as I used to. And I don't mind admitting, I'm getting lots of interested looks from the ladies. One of the gals at the clubhouse told me I looked just like Omar Sharif. I'm afraid your mother is jealous of all the attention I'm getting. She makes fun of me because I bought the toupee at a thrift shop, but look who's talking. This is a woman who buys steaks from the shopping channel. Every supermarket in town sells steaks, but no, your mother has to buy them from the television. And she makes fun of me because I bought my hair at a thrift shop. Take care, honey. Your loving daddy. P.S. Here's a cute joke I heard at the clubhouse. What goes clop-clop, bang-bang, clop-clop? An Armenian drive-by shooting. To Daddy-O, from Jostin. Thanks for the joke, Daddy, but I think it's supposed to be an Amish drive-by shooting, because their horses go clop-clop. Get it? About your new head of hair, are you sure you want to be wearing a used toupee? I mean, you have no idea who might have worn it before you. What if they had a scalp disease? To Jostin, from Daddy-O. Subject, previously owned. First of all, honey, my toupee is not used, it's previously owned. The lady at the thrift shop told me it belonged to Burt Reynolds, either him or Sam Donaldson. And no need to worry about germs. I've already sprayed it with Lysol. To Jostin, from Shop Till You Drop. Subject, self-respecting germ. Your father just sprayed his toupee with Lysol. He needn't have bothered. No self-respecting germ would be caught dead in that wig. I've simply got to think of a way to get rid of it. Your desperate mom.
Chapter 3. I sat on SueEllen Kingsley's toilet bowl with a sense of foreboding. Not about the book. After 5 minutes listening to SueEllen prattle, I knew her book, At Home with SueEllen, would never see the light of day. Not with recipes that began, Have your maid debone a turkey. This was a woman who probably needed directions to get to her kitchen. No, I was worried about my father. Ever since my parents retired to Florida, Daddy's been acting nuttier than ever. Last year, for example, he was convinced my mother was having an affair with one of the hosts from the home shopping club. And now this business about buying a toupee at a thrift shop. What sort of person buys a used toupee? I only hoped he wasn't going to wind up one of those crazy old men who take out their dentures in restaurants. Oh well, there was no use worrying about it. With my parents living 3,000 miles away in Florida, there was nothing I could do. I forced myself to listen to SueEllen, who was stretched out in the tub, rambling on about her childhood in the Deep South. We may not have had much money, she said, but from an early age, I learned the art of gracious living. She picked up a pumice stone from a bath tray and began scraping away at her calluses. In addition to the pumice stone, her bath tray held such grooming necessities as a bottle of Cristal champagne, a Walkman TV, and a half-eaten salad. I eyed her salad covetously, mainly because I was starving. I'd shown up at 1 o'clock that afternoon, as instructed. Conchi fixed us lunch, eensy-weensy turkey cob salads, with hardly enough turkey to feed a flea. I snarfed mine down in nanoseconds, sitting on the toilet bowl. SueEllen barely nibbled at hers. Now it was going on 4 o'clock, and I was ready to eat the wallpaper. Mother and Dad came from old Southern aristocracy, SueEllen said, flicking the dead skin from her calluses into the water. By the time I came along, the family money was pretty much gone. Mother clung to the old traditions, though, and passed them on to me. She taught me how to make chicken and dumplings and mint juleps and sweet little lavender sachets. I was a rebel, though. Back then, I was more interested in boys than good manners. She looked up from her pumice stone and frowned. How come you're not writing any of this down?
Because Margaret Mitchell already wrote it. It's called Gone with the Wind. Okay, so I didn't really say that.
I'm sorry, I smiled. It was just so interesting, I guess I forgot to take notes.
I scribbled down the stuff about the lavender sachets and dumplings. Any minute now, I expected her to tell me about her mammy and them cotton fields back home.
Of course, she said. The biggest influence in my life was my Aunt Melanie.
She reached for her champagne and took a sip. I'd long since polished off the Diet Coke Conchie had served me.
Aunt Melanie married well and had scads of money. She threw the most marvelous parties, and I never forgot them. Yes, I guess you could say Aunt Melanie was the one who taught me everything I know about party planning.
So I wrote that down, too, wondering if she'd notice if I reached over and filched some croutons from her salad. I wouldn't have minded another Diet Coke, either, and a cushion. I was getting a mighty sore tush from sitting on the toilet for 3 hours. SueEllen had a bathroom the size of a football stadium. Why on earth couldn't she at least bring in a chair for me? SueEllen droned on about Aunt Melanie and her recipe for bourbon pecan balls. I was alternately taking notes and fantasizing about a cheeseburger with fries when I glanced out the window and saw an elderly man standing on the balcony of the house next door. Normally, I don't get upset when elderly men stand on their balconies, but this man was looking through a telescope that just happened to be pointed straight at SueEllen's boobs.
SueEllen, I said,
I don't want to alarm you, but your neighbor is spying on you.
Oh, that's old Mr. Zeller, she said,
sipping her champagne, not the least bit perturbed.
He's a retired astronomy professor. Used to teach at Caltech. Don't worry, he's harmless. Yoo-hoo, Mr. Zeller! She sat up straight in the tub, giving him an unobstructed view of her boobs. And then she blew him a kiss. Good Lord, she was actually getting off on this. Now that would make an interesting chapter for a book. She could call it Entertaining the Neighbors. At least we wouldn't have to bother with recipes. An hour later, SueEllen was still strolling down memory lane, and I was ready to strangle her. I hadn't been off that damn toilet seat all afternoon, except to add hot water to her tub.
You don't mind, do you? She'd asked. I'm so comfortable in the water, I hate to move.
Heavens no. I wouldn't want her to exert herself by actually having to turn on a faucet. So I'd smiled weakly and turned on the hot water. I felt like a slave girl in one of those old 50s biblical epics. I checked my watch. 5:10. I couldn't believe it. The woman was about to break the Guinness record for the world's longest bath. Even I don't stay in the tub for 4 hours at a stretch. But here she was, still soaking and still yapping. By now, of course, I was famished. I would have sold my soul for a tic-tac. Finally, after what seemed like hours but was probably only 10 minutes, SueEllen called it a day and got out of the tub.
Hand me my robe, will you, dear?
She said, flaunting her fabulous body. Not an ounce of fat anywhere. I wondered if she'd had any of it sucked away by her plastic surgeon husband. Just as she was tying the belt on her robe, a buzzer sounded. SueEllen crossed to a control panel above her bath and pressed a button.
Yes? Who is it?
A young man's voice filtered through a speaker.
It's me, SueEllen. I forgot my key.
My stepson, Brad, SueEllen whispered to me. Always forgetting his key.
Okay, she said, pressing a button.
Come on in.
Once again, my mind boggled. What sort of person has an intercom for their bathtub?
Isn't this clever? She said. I had it installed, so in case the maid isn't around, I don't have to get out of the tub to answer the door. I don't know what I'd do without it.
Yeah, we all know how irritating it is when the maid isn't around to answer the door.
Hey, I've got an idea, she said. Why don't you stay for dinner? You can meet my husband and stepchildren, Brad and his sister Heidi.
Actually, I think I've already met Heidi. SueEllen shook her head in a gesture that was meant to portray sympathy.
Poor Heidi. Such a troubled child. Terrible weight problem. I'm sure you can relate.
Ouch, that one hurt.
My heart goes out to the poor darling, she said, scrutinizing her face in a magnifying mirror and squeezing a blackhead. So I've been helping her with her diet. One of these days, she's going to look just fine. So how about it? She said. Will you stay for dinner?
Was she kidding? If I had to listen to one more word about Aunt Melanie and her damned pecan balls, I'd go bonkers. No way was I staying for dinner. I'd head straight home.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.